Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for watching. This show is all about giving you insights and showcasing brands that help you to live your best life and give you confidence. As always, I want to kickstart your morning with some motivational advice to help you to feel inspired and energized to start your day. Today, I want to talk about the importance of focus. Without a razor-sharp focus on the goals we want to accomplish, it's very easy to fall off track. Razor-sharp focus on our goals allows us to stay in our lane and have our eyes on the prize. Of course, distractions are always there, but with a clear vision and focus, we can keep distractions at bay. To develop razor-sharp focus on our goals, we must first get clear on what that goal is. Do you want to become an entrepreneur? Become a chef? Own your own yoga studio? Whatever that goal is, become clear on what it is you want. Clarity allows us to focus our time and energy the right way. Another tip is to get clear on why you want to accomplish that goal. Do you want to inspire others? Has your goal always been your lifelong passion? When we remind ourselves why we want to accomplish our goal, it makes it easier to give 100% of our attention and focus on finding solutions to make that goal happen. It allows us to not lose sight of these goals when we experience obstacles. Remember, life is meant to evolve into the best version of ourselves. Where our focus goes, energy flows, so make sure you're investing your time and energy into things that push you towards living your best life.
What does luxury mean to you?
Luxury. In India, I discovered that true luxury isn't something you buy off a shelf. True luxury is a feeling that you are the Maharani of your world. And it can be all designed around you. All the beauty is yours. All the music is yours. India showed me that luxury doesn't follow designers and brands. True luxury follows its own heart.
Incredible India.
Joining us now is Lori Santos, who is an American psychologist and cognitive scientist who is a professor at Yale University. She is also the professor of the popular online course, The Science of Well-Being, which is being offered free right now at Yale University. Lori, thank you so much for being on the show today. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me.
So let's just dive into it. One of the best things about this quarantine for me has been finding your course, The Science of Well-Being. Let's talk about it.
Yeah, so the course started as an attempt to teach Yale students about the science of happiness. I am a head of college on campus, and so I really wanted students to learn more about the strategies they could use to feel a lot better. And so I created a class that we ran live at Yale back in 2018. But that class wound up becoming the most popular class in Yale's 300-year history. Over 1,000 students wanted to take it. And that made us realize that the class content was applicable not just to students who were at Yale, but probably lots of folks around the world wanted to figure out ways that they could flourish better, ways that they could feel better. And so we decided to put the class online completely for free. It's available on Coursera.org and called The Science of Well-Being.
And let's talk about some of the findings that you had. I found this course really interesting, and it's definitely made me feel a lot better and happier, to be honest. So let's talk about some of the findings. I don't want to ruin the course for anyone that's watching, but let's talk about some of the findings that you did find.
One of the things we teach about in the class is the misconceptions that we all have about happiness and how we get it. I think this is one of the most important features of the class because we have to overcome our misconceptions if we want to learn more about the things we can do to be happier. And so we walk through evidence suggesting that money doesn't really make you happy. Unless you're living below the poverty line, getting more money isn't going to make you much happier. We talk through evidence that material possessions, all your circumstances, basically the main things we think matter for happiness, don't really affect happiness in the way we think. And then we turn to the question of like, well, why is that? We walk through different psychological biases that make things like money and things like material possessions not as good for our well-being as we think. Mm-hmm. But then the rest of the course is really spent on what I think is the most important part. We dig into the things that really do matter for happiness. And they're things that we often don't expect. They're things like social connection, becoming a little bit more other-oriented, taking time for things like gratitude, and even healthy habits like exercise and sleep and meditation. Turns out those are the things that really matter.
And let's talk about some of the annoying features that you talk about. And as well as we think that certain things will make us happy, but they actually don't.
Money is like such a classic case in point. You know, so many people think if I could just win the lottery or just become rich, then all my problems would be solved. But if you look scientifically at the people to whom that has happened, you know, people who've actually won the lottery, you know, they're happy at first, but then they kind of just go back to baseline. This is true for the good events in our life, but it's also true for the bad events in our life too. You know, you take cases of somebody who's injured in an accident and becomes paraplegic. Of course, when that first happens, it's awful. But if you really interview folks to whom that's happened, what they'll say is that those things ended up being positive events in their life. Sometimes folks say that it was a meaningful event that changed their life for the better. And so this gets to the first annoying feature of the mind, which is that we have minds that kind of just get used to stuff, both the good stuff, the kind of lottery wins of the world, but also the bad stuff, you know, these kind of bad events that hurt our health and hurt our well-being. We kind of just, you know, get used to them over time. This is a scientific concept called hedonic adaptation, but it's one of the reasons that our circumstances don't affect us as much as we think.
Have you found that this program has made you happier, and have you applied some of these tactics?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the great thing about being the professor that teaches this class is that I have to practice what I preach. Otherwise, it's kind of embarrassing. You know, so if I'm not practicing social connection or meditating or these things, my students will notice and they will definitely call me on it. But the great news is that if you practice these habits, as the science suggests, you will improve your well-being. And so for me personally, I'm about 1 point higher on a standard 10-point measure of well-being, which is pretty remarkable, and it's a real significant increase for me.
Mm-hmm. And did you measure your students' happiness at the end of the course, and did you see a significant difference?
We didn't actually measure students' happiness before and after during the Yale class. We encourage students to do this on their own, but because the class like blindsided me so much with 1,000 students, we kind of didn't get it together to do like real scientific studies. We're doing that now as part of the online Coursera class. And so learners, if they want to, can opt into a study where we measure happiness before and after the class. And what we're seeing so far is that learners are showing significant increases in their happiness. They also show increases in self-reported positive emotion, self-reported meaning, and even self-reported social connection and relationships. And so it does seem like the class is helping. Of course, the problem is that you have to do what the class is teaching you. You can't just learn about these facts. Definitely. You actually have to put them into practice.
Yeah, and let's talk about gratitude. I know that you said that writing things that you're grateful for really boosts your happiness, as well as writing a letter to someone and expressing maybe how they changed their life or they changed your life. Let's talk about that and gratitude and the importance of that.
Yeah, I think this one's super important right now and just in culture in general. I feel like we don't really have a culture of gratitude. We have a culture of kind of griping and complaining and sort of not looking at the bright side of things. But happy people simply don't do that. Happy people spontaneously count their blessings. They spontaneously bring to mind all the things they're grateful for. And so if we, maybe not so happy folks, want to take a tip from the happy people, we can just copy that behavior. This simple act of writing down 3 to 5 things you're grateful for every night can significantly boost your well-being in as little as 2 weeks. And the act of expressing gratitude, like not just kind of scribbling it down in a gratitude journal, but telling the people in your life, say, that you're grateful for, that you really value them, that can be a big boost, of course, to their well-being, but it's also a huge boost to your well-being. In fact, one study by Marty Seligman and his colleagues show that the act of expressing gratitude publicly to someone else can boost your well-being for over a month.
Amazing. Let's talk about your background. Of course, you're a psychologist. You're a professor at Yale, such an impressive background. When did you realize that psychology was your passion?
I think it started early on. I was always one of those annoying kids that wanted to know what the adults were doing and to like hang out with the adults. I think I was analyzing everyone's behavior from a really early age. But I learned that psychology was a field when I first got to college. I had some fantastic mentors, professors and grad students who I started working with really early on. And I realized that this wasn't just a thing that I was kind of curious about. This was a scientific enterprise that had answers. You know, we could really figure out the puzzles of human nature, things like, you know, what is the kind of thing that makes our minds special? What is the kind of things that make us happy? We can look scientifically at those questions. And that was just a whole awakening for me because, you know, there's lots of scientific fields that help people, but the science of psychology is really about who we are as people and how we can better interact in the world in ways that keep us happier and healthier. So it was just a really fun field for me to study. And when I got, as soon as I got exposed to it, I kind of dove right in.
Yeah. And I think you're such a great teacher. It's actually kind of surreal seeing you on screen just because I am doing the course. So seeing you on screen, it's amazing. So thank you for being here today. Yeah. Let's talk about, as a psychologist, what are some tips and tricks that you can give people to maybe boost their happiness right now, the people that are at home and maybe feeling isolated? What kind of advice would you have for them?
Yeah, I think that, thank you for asking that question, because I think this is so important right now. You know, we all know the things we need to do to boost our physical health right now. You know, we need to be washing our hands and socially distancing. But I think a lot of people are looking for actionable tips they can use to boost their mental health right now. You know, we're all feeling a little panicked, you know, really uncertain, kind of anxious, and those are yucky feelings, but the science suggests we don't have to feel that way. And so in terms of some quick tips, one of the biggest tips I think is to make sure you're focused on social connection during this time of social distancing. Every available survey of happy people suggests that social connection and rich social relationships are a necessary feature of happiness. And so that necessary feature of happiness is not necessarily a priority right now in this sort of strange situation that we find ourselves in, right? So many of us are either alone or just like hanging out with a few close family members. You know, many of us haven't seen our friends now for a couple weeks or even a month. But the good news is that social distancing doesn't need to mean social disconnection. We can use technologies to connect with the people we care about. You know, you and I are talking over Zoom right now in this strange time when you're recording, you know, TV episodes from your house. And we can just use the same technologies to hang out with close friends of ours. So I personally have been doing a lot of like informal social connection over platforms like Zoom. I do little yoga classes with friends of mine, do dinners with friends in other time zones. I even have a weekly dinner now with my mom, who's in a different time zone, and my brother, who's off in a still different time zone. And the whole point of that is that by scheduling these kinds of social connections intentionally, in ways where you can see people in real time, right? Not in real life, but in real time, where you're seeing people's facial expressions and their laughter and so on. Like, those things are basically what we need to feel socially connected with other people. We just need to put a little bit more effort into doing that intentionally during this crazy time.
And what's been your favorite thing about teaching this course?
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of things. I mean, one is just selfishly, it's forced me to do all these practices, right? Which I kind of need myself to improve my well-being. But I think beyond that, like, the class has really allowed me to reach so many new people, people I never would have met otherwise. You know, I'm constantly getting emails from like learners who just say, thank you so much. You know, here's how the class changed my life. Or even learners who have new ideas. You know, I put the class content into effect in this new way. And I'm like, oh, that's a great idea. I'm gonna steal that one. And so just having a class that can affect so many people and can reach so many people has just been amazing.
Yeah. And what would you say to encourage our viewers to do this program? Because it is a little timely, but I really do think it's a great course. So what would you say to encourage them?
Yeah. I mean, I think what I would say is that, you know, all of us are probably feeling a little unhappy these days, right? Or at least like we're not flourishing as much as we could be. I think that was generally true even before this crisis, but I think this crisis has brought it really to the fore for a lot of people. And what I would say is just that that doesn't have to be the case. Like, science gives us these evidence-based tips that you can use to feel better. You just have to learn what they are. You have to put them into practice. And so the class is available on Coursera for anyone who wants to take it. But if you're listening to this thinking, you know, in the middle of a pandemic, I super don't have time to take a whole Yale class. We've also put a lot of tips online as part of a new podcast that I put together called The Happiness Lab. You can download The Happiness Lab wherever you get your podcasts. And that's, you know, a little simpler. It's like these short, you know, 20-minute podcasty tips that you can use during this crisis too.
I wanted to go back, actually. There was something I wanted to ask you about social connection. There was something interesting that you had mentioned during the course, that we think that social connection won't make us happy. It's a misconception that we have, and that even talking to a stranger, even as nerve-wracking as it could be, it makes us happier. So let's talk about that, because I thought it was very interesting.
Yeah, this is one of the studies that I think people find most surprising in the class. This is some work by Nick Epley and his colleagues where he forced people to be social with complete strangers. He did this on the L train in Chicago. So one group of subjects were forced to talk to a stranger on the train for their entire train ride, whereas another group of subjects were just allowed to kind of be silent, you know, just try to enjoy your solitude. And what he finds is that the people who talk to strangers are happier afterwards than the folks that just were silent. But he also tests a different group of subjects and makes them predict. And those subjects have, you know, kind of the same prediction I had when I first heard about this study, which is that that connection condition is just gonna feel weird. Like, it's just gonna be strange to like forcibly talk to some stranger on the train. But what Nick finds is that that's not the case. And I think this is really important. It's part of a larger picture that we're getting about the science of well-being, which is that we don't often know the things that are gonna be really good for us. And that means that we're putting effort into becoming happier, but we're doing it in a way that's not going to work. You know, take this crisis right now, you know, oftentimes I'm thinking like, oh, I wanna do something that makes me feel better. But I might not realize that, you know, putting that effort in to schedule a Zoom call with, say, my college roommates is gonna feel good, right? My prediction is like, oh, it's gonna be kind of a pain. It's not gonna work in the way I think. You know, I'll just panic scroll on Twitter or something like that. But the idea is that we're doing the wrong things. We're not picking the activities that can make us happiest because we have these incorrect theories about the sorts of things that improve our well-being.
Mm-hmm. And you know, everyone's on social media, everyone's bored on their phones. Do you think that, you know, being on social media too much, kind of, because people are seeking connection, do you think that that is kind of decreasing our happiness?
I think it depends on how you're using social media. I mean, I think if you're using things like, you know, Facebook Live events where you're talking to people and seeing them in real time, that's different than just scrolling through a feed and clicking like. You know, we really need social connection that's in real time, where we see each other, you know, can experience each other's laughter and talk to each other and so on. You know, just kind of scrolling through a feed doesn't really work. But honestly, it's kind of up to you in terms of how social media is making you feel. One of the tips we give in class is to just be mindful about how you're feeling, especially now in the context of this COVID-19 crisis. You know, if you're spending some time scrolling through an Instagram feed, pause, you know, 10 minutes in and say, okay, how am I feeling right now? Is this making me feel good? Am I feeling joy? Am I laughing? Or am I kind of feeling sort of yucky and apathetic or even bad about myself? Mm-hmm. Like, by being mindful about how those activities are making you personally feel, you can get a sense of which ones are useful for you and which ones are not.
Mm-hmm. And how do you think people should invest their time right now? Because they're bored, of course, taking the Coursera Yale course, but how can people kind of put their time and energy, or what can they put their time and energy into right now that you recommend?
I think one of the things to do is to be a little bit more intentional about that question, right? Because if we don't kind of come up with a list of the sorts of things we should be doing right now, then it's easy when we're feeling kind of stressed and bored to just like fall back into whatever's easy. Like, you know, you can kill hours and hours just scrolling through social media when you could have done something, you know, maybe better for your time, better in terms of your own well-being. And so I think one thing is to just come up with your own kind of time windfall list, you know, a list of the kinds of things that you really wished you had time to do. And now maybe you have time to do them. That could be reading a book or learning a new language or so on. Another thing to do is just to kind of learn more about the activities that really do boost well-being. You know, you heard already about social connection or taking time to express gratitude, but other good ones are just taking time for healthy habits, you know, getting back to a good cardio routine, or even prioritizing sleep. You know, if you have the opportunity, you know, go to bed a little earlier or stay in bed a little longer. Those kinds of things can really bump up mental health. And especially exercise and sleep can also be great for immune function, which is another thing we should be bumping up right now, too. Mm-hmm.
I think that's great advice. Lastly, I want to ask you, what do you think people can take away from this pandemic?
I'm actually really hopeful that we're all going to leave this pandemic a little bit happier. And I think that for a couple of reasons. One is I've seen so many people putting into practice positive habits right now, habits that are going to improve their well-being now during this crisis, but even maybe after the crisis too. You know, people are engaging in new creative pursuits. They're learning how to bake, or they're getting involved in new activities, new crafts, and so on. People are reconnecting with people they haven't talked to in a long time, or doing really nice random acts of kindness, you know, reaching out to elderly neighbors. Mm-hmm. All of those things are important for our well-being now. But if we form those habits in the context of this crisis, those are behaviors that we can take beyond the crisis too. You know, we can keep doing those things once this crisis is over. And engaging in new positive habits now means that you might have those habits when we finish too. The second reason I'm super positive is that we know that we've been missing so many things in the context of this crisis. You know, I'm missing just going to my coffee shop and grabbing a latte in the morning, or seeing friends and family members, you know, going to the movies. You know, there's so many things we're missing out on that we've realized that we were taking those things for granted. Absolutely. In other words, we weren't as grateful as we could be about all those things. You know, I know that myself. Like, I just would every morning walk in and get a latte, and I wasn't like overjoyed that the coffee shop was open and that I had the opportunity to get this delicious latte. Now I realize, you know, how unwise I was being before. I should have been incredibly joyful at those opportunities. And so I think when this crisis is over, and it will be over, we're going to go back to those seemingly normal behaviors with an incredible amount of gratitude. We're going to realize what a blessing they were, and we're not going to take them for granted. And that means we're going to savor them and enjoy those activities much more than we ever did before. Yeah. And so I think those are two behaviors that we're going to take from this crisis that overall are going to make us happier when this is done.
Yeah, I think that's great advice and such a great outlook to take gratitude away from all this, because I do think that when we all go back into the real world, we're definitely going to be a lot more grateful and appreciate every little thing. Where can people connect with you on social media?
Yeah, so you can follow me on Twitter at Lori Santos, and you can definitely check me out online at the Happiness Lab podcast, which I hope everyone will connect there. You can find me at happinesslab.fm. And I hope that everyone checks out Coursera.org, which is where you can find the Science of Wellbeing class.
Amazing. Well, thank you, Lori, so much for being on the show today. I already feel so much happier just speaking to you because you have such a great energy about you. So thank you.
Thanks so much for having me.
Tag TV is available on Roku, Amazon Fire TV, Apple and Android TVs, as well as on Apple and Android phones. Join us live on YouTube and Facebook.